Hachette Audio presents Too Dumb to Fail, how the GOP betrayed the Reagan Revolution to win elections, and how it can reclaim its conservative roots. Written and read by Matt K. Lewis.
This book is dedicated to Burke and Beckett. Introduction. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7. In September of 2010, I took part in a conservative think tank panel discussion on the rise of a new phenomenon known as the Tea Party, a loose-knit group of aspiring activists who previously were not engaged in the political process. In contrast to the other panelists, I argued that, while the entry of new activists and voters into politics was usually a welcome development, the characteristics that came to define the Tea Party posed significant challenges to the Republican Party. Doubling down on anti-intellectualism, courting isolationism, and taking cues from amateurs who lacked experience and professionalism. My comments, though delivered in a tone I considered measured and thoughtful, evoked murmuring and at least a few audible gasps. The question hanging on the lips of many audience members was clear. Why wasn't a conservative writer blindly cheering this seminal moment in conservative movement history? One of the forum's other speakers was an avuncular and sharp conservative leader who had worked for Ronald Reagan and George H.W. Bush, and he was now the head of an important conservative organization. At the event, he bristled at my remarks. "That's just what people said about the Christian coalition in the 1980s, he charged, winning the crowd's approval. A few days later, while direct messaging with one of his aides on Twitter, I learned the truth. "He agreed with everything you said," the aide confided. "He just thought it was foolish to say so out loud." This is the dirty little secret of the conservative movement in America today. Everyone knows that it's lost its intellectual bearings. Empty-headed talking point reciters, rookie politicians who've never managed anything in their lives, media clowns such as Donald Trump, dim bulbs in tight pants or short skirts, professionally outraged shout-fest talking heads, and total political neophytes dominate conservative airwaves and the right's political discourse. It wasn't always like this. A half century ago, the presidential candidacy of Barry Goldwater was nearing a disastrous end. Lyndon Johnson, Goldwater's Democratic opponent in the 1964 election, had bludgeoned the Arizona senator as a conservative extremist who would recklessly start a nuclear war. Trailing in every poll with time dwindling, Goldwater's supporters, led by an auto dealer named Holmes Tuttle, decided to spend a small fortune for 30 minutes of airtime. To make the case for Goldwater, they chose a former actor and Screen Actors Guild president named Ronald Reagan. Officially titled A Time for Choosing, the spot became known simply as The Speech. The story of how it came to be is interesting. Reagan, who was then serving as co-chairman of Californians for Goldwater, traveled the state, stumping for his candidate. After addressing a fundraiser in Los Angeles, Reagan recalled that he was approached by a delegation of high-powered Republicans who asked if he would deliver the speech on TV, if they funded it. "I said yes and suggested that, instead of just having me in a studio alone, they bring in an audience to get a better feel," he recalled. Reagan began his address by remarking that he had chosen his own words and would be discussing his own ideas. Back in 1964, neither of those facts was especially startling. Political speakers frequently wrote their own speeches, and the political arena still welcomed the debate of big ideas. Goldwater and his team initially opposed the plan, fearing Reagan would overshadow Goldwater. Of course, he did. But the speech also helped raise millions of dollars for Goldwater's campaign. And, of course, it ultimately served as the catalyst that would make Ronald Reagan the president 16 years later. At a time when the electorate was still comfortable with Franklin Roosevelt's big government philosophy, and the United Nations was still seen as maintaining global peace, Reagan's promotion of free market principles and hawkish foreign policy challenged conventional wisdom of the day. But what was not unusual is that the speech had substance. In his first minute and a half, Reagan effortlessly cited eight statistics. And the next half hour, he cited 40 more. Behind his command of details and data was an elevated rhetoric that challenged his listeners to consider the long history of man's relation to man and his long climb from the swamp to the stars. Reagan's address fell short of reversing Goldwater's dissent, but it propelled Reagan's own election win 2 years later as the next governor of California, when he vanquished the once popular two-term New Deal Democrat, Pat Brown. 20 years later, when he was elected to his second term in the White House with the support of 49 states, he could look back at the words he chose in October of 1964 and the speech that started the Reagan Revolution. Today, almost everything about Reagan's address is inconceivable. No political consultant would advise a struggling campaign to buy 30 minutes of airtime for an ideological monologue. We assume the modern attention span demands information in 30-second installments or less, preferably with alternately ominous and pathetic music and computer graphics. The video sharing service Vine features looping videos just 6 seconds long, and the service is wildly popular. Today, no aspiring politician would deliver a speech that wasn't poll-tested, consultant-crafted, and focus group-approved. Reagan's speech had instead been honed by decades of Reagan's reading, thinking, and writing about history, economics, and international relations. But who has time for all that? As it turns out, the answer is just about every significant political leader in American history, including the likes of John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, Daniel Webster, Henry Clay, Stephen Douglas, Abraham Lincoln, William Seward, Thaddeus Stevens, William Jennings Bryan, Theodore Roosevelt, Woodrow Wilson, Calvin Coolidge, Franklin Roosevelt, Barry Goldwater, and Ronald Reagan. As unimaginable as it sounds, there was once a time when Americans could turn on their televisions and not expect to hear a parade of tired and trite talking points spewed forth from a split screen of four screaming pundits with no experience or expertise and whatever ratings-driven controversy cable news had manufactured for that day. Ideas mattered. Men and women fought over ideas and thought before they spoke. Politicians speaking on television and writing in newspapers, ask your parents, were judged by their expertise and eloquence, not their ability to outshout the medley of other amateur gas bags vying to entertain and excite an audience that long ago surrendered any hope of being informed or inspired. The Republican Party is called the Grand Old Party for a reason. It was founded on big ideas, abolishing slavery and holding together a federal republic. But the dumbing down of the GOP has gone on for so long that nearly half of Republicans don't know what that acronym, GOP, stands for. I'm not suggesting that liberals are immune to these problems. They faced similar struggles in past decades and settled for simplistic solutions. Over the years, liberals came to believe a university president could keep us out of war, that a plain-speaking peanut farmer could restore honor to Washington after Watergate, and that a community organizer could unite America. Democrats went through their own time in the wilderness, losing 3 consecutive presidential elections from 1980 to 1992. But their identity crisis didn't coincide with the time when respect for institutions was declining, when outside groups made it possible for backbench politicians to usurp a leader's authority without fear of retribution, and when a technological revolution meant any Tom, Dick, or Harry could have a megaphone and a printing press on his smartphone. Palinized? Perhaps it's not fair to compare the mediums, but just for a second, juxtapose Ronald Reagan's 1964 speech and one of former Alaska Governor Sarah Palin's infamous posts to her 4 million plus fans on Facebook, which concluded with the words, "Thank you, prayer warriors, I love you." Until Palin came along, Reagan was the last Republican to generate euphoric excitement within the party, and he was not without flaws. But from his first televised address to his last, he appealed, in his words, to your best hopes, not your worst fears, to your confidence rather than your doubts. He did not, as Palin does, blame the liberal media for his problems. In fact, He was not quick to blame anyone for his problems, or yours. Solutions mattered more than indictments. Ideas mattered more than enemies. And his nation mattered more than his ego. The product of a generation that prized actions over words, he showed his love for our country by serving it, not closing his statements by calling out, "I love you." For Reagan.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.